My name is Richard Newell. I'm working in the Security Working Group, and we have a little bit of a report here, which is mostly on the crypto extensions. Okay, so the working group has worked mainly in two areas. First one is kind of a broad area of trusted execution, isolation, and secure boot, things related, you know, to having a secure execution of code. The other area is the cryptographic extensions. So the trusted execution is a work in progress. A lot of work yet to do in that area. Recently kind of changing direction, and so we have nothing to present on that topic today. The rest of the talk is going to be on the cryptographic extensions. It's also a work in progress, not finished, but you can see, you know, the PowerPoint is coming along, and our hope is to have a written spec in Barcelona. Okay, so the proposal for the crypto extensions is to rely very heavily upon the vector extensions, which you just heard about from Roger. And a couple of good reasons for this. One is we generally deal with very wide words in crypto. You know, kind of a small word for us is 128 bits, and we might be talking about 4,000 bits or 8,000 bits. So we need a lot of space to store that. So we're going to take advantage of the vector registers, which could be arbitrarily long, depending upon the implementation. And the other thing is we use different data types, long integers, of course, but also Galois field, a couple different types, bit strings, keys, and the dynamic typing capability in the vector extension is suited very well for this, too. So the plan is to use vector functional units to do all the arithmetic that's commonly used in public key cryptography. And then we're going to also still use the wide registers for symmetric cryptography like AES or hashing operations. But those most likely will be more customized accelerators, just as if you were, you know, building a crypto accelerator and, you know, with any other kind of API on it. So there's no restriction on whether these are small or big, use a few gates or a lot of gates, you know, whether they're fast or slow. An example, you could have AES, could be implemented with one single S box, could process a byte at a time. It could take, you know, you have to do 16 bytes to get a round, you have to do 14 rounds to get a complete AES transformation. So that would be very small, but it'd take, you know, 160 clocks or so to get done. That's one choice. Another choice, you could put in a you know, completely full AES implementation with 16 S boxes times 14 rounds, completely pipelined, whatever that is, 200 and some S boxes, and it could chunk out 128 bits every single clock cycle. So that's your choice. You implement it any way you like. Okay, and you could put in multiple of those, so you could have multiple lanes of 128 bits. And so you could build something that does easily gigabits per second, you know, with this proposal, or you could do something that takes 160 clocks to kick out 128 bits. Okay, so back to public key crypto. So I'm using elliptic curve here as sort of an example. It's representative of a lot of public key crypto, which is based upon long number types, Galois fields. Represented as a long strings of binary numbers, and a lot of the time which is spent in public key crypto is spent doing the arithmetic, the simple adds and especially the multiplies take a long time. So if you have very, very long numbers in RSA, you might be dealing with, you know, 2,000 or 4,000 bit numbers. Your multiplier is probably not that big. And so you have a lot of partial products you're calculating and adding up all these partial products, and it takes a lot of time and a lot of instructions to do that. And we're basically saying that we're going to do all that arithmetic in the hardware, but then all the other things that you do with those long numbers, how you make digital signatures, how you do, let's say, scalar point multiplication for elliptic cryptography, that still will all be in software. But the software will be using vector instructions to take advantage of all that underlying arithmetic, which is all being done under the hood. So you can get a 2,000 by 2,000 bit multiply with one instruction. In fact, you can get multiple 2,000 by 2,000 multiplies if your vector registers are long enough, because you could vectorize it, and you could do a bunch of them at once. Again, how that's implemented is, again, totally up to you. You could have a little 32 by 32 multiplier. It's going around and doing everything. Or you could have, you know, bigger multipliers or multiple bigger multipliers. It's all up to the implementation. But the ISA interface will be saying the we're going to use multiply and add instructions, which are already in the ISA. Roger just described those, and the software will just refer to those with the dynamic types. So talking about types, so Roger said there's a 16 bits type register, and part of that, this is a proposal to use 5 bits of that 16 bits for the type. And you can see the types that Roger mentioned in the top part in the light blue, so you've got three types there, the unsigned, signed, and floating point at various widths. And then a proposal for the crypto extension. So if you add the crypto extension on top of the vector extension, then you'll add these Galois field types of various types in Montgomery representation and binary extension fields, et cetera. And we're proposing a special type for keys. We haven't quite decided what that means yet, but there'd be some kind of restrictions maybe in how something which is declared as a key would be accessed. And then the foundation will keep other types. And again, Roger mentioned UNORM 24-bit. So that would be an example of something that, you know, the foundation could say that one of the encodings stands for UNORM and be able to handle that. Okay, so the foundation basically in this proposal would, you know, own the definition of the first 24 types. There'd be a few types that would be left undefined, and users could make custom types. Of course, users that aren't coordinating with each other, they're going to collide, and there'll be chaos in that part. But the first 24 will be organized by the foundation so that everybody can count on UNORM 24 or Galois field 128, for example. Okay, then in width. So you see we're talking about, you know, a lot of different widths for crypto especially. But also in graphics and machine learning, there's, you know, a lot of kind of specialized widths. And the proposal here is to have widths from 1 to 12, all inclusive. And then after that, we go in a sequence that goes times 1.5 times 2, so 16, 24, 32, 48. And that picks up 99% of the widths that are commonly used in crypto, up to 4,096. However, there's a few odd ones, and of course, there's always exceptions. And so we propose kind of an escape mechanism where three of the codes would go out to longer registers, and you could store a number in there like 8096 or 16384 for really big RSA keys, or 521, because there happens to be a NIST standard for elliptic curves that uses 521-bit keys, and that doesn't fit in our table nicely, so that would use the escape mechanism. Okay. Encoding, a plan is to use just one major opcode to encode everything I've talked about, besides, of course, the ones that were just dynamically changing the types from the vector extension. But for the specialized crypto functions, we'll use one major opcode. And these encodings pretty much line up with the ones that Roger showed you. And everything, of course, is subject to change, because Roger's still changing things, and then we'll change things to make things line up. The idea is that there would be this function field would be used to define the crypto operation that's being done, like encrypt or decrypt or a hash, a padding, stripping padding, maybe wrapping a key and unwrapping a key, and things like that would be functions that would be encoded in the 4 bits. And then 3 bits would go to a kind of escape to another table, and we'd convert from 3 bits to 8 bits, do a 3 bit to 8 bit mapping. And this, again, all subject to change. Maybe we don't need 8 bits, maybe 7 or 6 is good enough. And then keep a reserved list of algorithms in encoding. Now, you don't have to implement any or all of these algorithms. I mean, we think a lot of people will do AES, maybe SHA-2. The others are the reserve to prevent chaos and collisions, so that people who are implementing triple DES, which is still widely used in finance, for instance, when somebody's writing a library, they know the code for triple DES. It's not different from one chip to another chip. So the purpose of the reserving all these encodings is to keep things orderly for library developers. And just like before, the foundation would own some big part of this list and keep that part organized, and then there'd be a little bit of room at the end for custom instructions, and their chaos will reign because some guy's gonna want to implement Simon or Spec or something that's not on our list, and they can do that, but they have to use an encoding that's not reserved by the foundation. Okay, and then we'll probably have a three operand instruction as well. So this looks like the format for the fused multiply add with three operands. And the third operand in this case is a reduction for the Galois field. So you put the reduction polynomial or the reduction prime number would be stored in a third register. Okay. And so speaking of the the kinds of crypto algorithms, started some work to look at what might be on the list of reserved encodings, and these are a variety of pretty common libraries and suites and certified crypto algorithms, and you can see, for instance, OpenSSL is implementing a lot of these. You don't have to implement a lot of these in hardware. You may decide that for your application, all you need to do is accelerate AES and SHA-2 or SHA-3, or you could choose which of these you implement. But this is eventually, we'll provide a list of the encodings that the foundation reserves, and the ones that we don't, you have to use the custom encoding space. And I think that's, one more thing, profile. So you've got all these lists of possible algorithms, and that itself can make for some chaos, just not knowing which ones every implementation has. And so we've got this idea of profiles. And I don't know if you remember in Krista's introduction yesterday, he brought up the idea of profiles. And this would be a way to try to drive implementations in certain areas to at least a minimum subset. So for instance, probably the most important profile for cryptography would be some kind of an internet communications profile. Say a lot of people are going to want to do TLS and IPsec and the internet standards, SSH. And a certain set of algorithms that will be most useful for those, maybe not the full set that TLS supports, but to some subset that we say this would be a good minimum subset that you should support if you're going to be doing internet communications. And so we will define in a separate document, we'll define some profiles that make sense. And finance, for instance, has to have triple DES, and cellular might be using Kasumi and Snow, and most of the people in the room probably don't care about Kasumi and Snow, but if you're making a cell phone base station, you have to have that, right? So we'll handle that with profiles. And that's that, and no questions. I'll just move right on to the next presentation, because I'm the next speaker. Okay.